where your passage is taken from. St. Paul talks about the peace that transcends all understanding. And some translations give it as the peace of God, which is so much greater than we can understand. And in the verses surrounding this verse, St. Paul deals with the subjects of peace with one another, peace within, and peace with God. And only then will you have perfect peace. So we shall take up each of these three statements, peace with one another, one by one, and see what it means to be now in right relationship with the world, with ourselves, and with God. The Our Father, which is the pattern of prayer that the Lord has given us, is a prayer of solidarity. The Heavenly Father to whom we pray, brothers and sisters, is part of the Blessed Trinity. And there is no loneliness there. There is only deep companionship and fellowship. The Father, Son, and Holy Spirit are overflowing with so much love for one another that they want to share that love with all of us. And whoever comes in contact with any of the three persons of the Trinity is automatically caught up in that fantastic atmosphere of love. And that is what Jesus wanted to communicate to us when he started teaching us the Our Father. Our, if you really want to be happy, Jesus said, you can't find happiness alone. No man can live as an island. We sing that song, journey through life alone. We here in the Trinity are a community of love. And I created you to be a community of love. So brothers and sisters, to be a son or a daughter of God, I also need to be a brother or a sister. Sometimes it seems that we want the fatherhood of God without the brotherhood or sisterhood of one another. And the paradox, my dear friends, my dear brothers and sisters in the Lord, is in our Eucharistic celebration. For example, we are happily, full-throatedly singing, make me a channel of your peace, make me an instrument of your love. And we leave the church carrying along the same hatred for our neighbor with which we came to the church. Do we bother to live out and act out the song? Do we bother to take the trouble and match up with those who have upset us? To be, in fact, channels of God. God's peace. What happens at Mass should relate to our life, brothers and sisters. But it appears that our rituals are only a substitute for reality. The words sung at Mass, at the penitential rite, or even at prayer meetings here like this, give us a great satisfaction, put us on an emotional high. But in most of our lives, they are merely substitutes for what should be happening in reality. I remember once I was singing to the Lord during a prayer meeting so beautifully, the reason I live is to worship you. And the Lord says, stop. Straight in my heart, I said, stop. That's a lie. The reason you live is not to worship you. There are so many other reasons. Such beautiful words, we are caught up, we are singing. But we can lie as much singing as in speaking. And that, what is that beautiful, what? That song that he sings so beautifully, can't get it now, whatever. It's, have your way in me, what is it? Every moment and every breath that I take, every moment I'm away, have your way in me. Just stop and think what we are saying. Every breath that you take, every moment I'm away, have your way. And when he starts, suddenly I say, Lord, what is this? So brothers and sisters, substitutes, we are seeing the way They are only substitute for what should be happening in reality. And we can think, we fool, our Lord, like Ananias and Sapphira in Acts chapter 5, who sold only a part of their land and thought they could fool and fool the Lord by keeping a part of the proceeds from them for themselves. But the mighty Holy Spirit gave Peter a word of knowledge that he had lied and grieved the Holy Spirit, and both of them fell dead and had to be carried out. Brothers and sisters, our Eucharistic celebrations are supposed to be that same agape meal celebrated in the times of the early Christians. An agape meal was a community meal in those days celebrated in the house of a wealthy person, a meal that cut across all social divisions. They would reach out to the poor, the marginalized people, so that no one was in want. And later they would celebrate the breaking of the bread. They lived the community experience first and then they celebrated the Eucharistic meal. Therefore we have St. Paul confronting the aberrations, all the upside down things that are happening in the Church of Corinth in his first letter to the Corinthians chapter 10. Are you there, brothers and sisters? Now in the Eucharist, before we communicate with God in Holy Communion, before we receive Him, we celebrate the sign of peace with our brothers and sisters. And this means, Lord, I am not coming to you to your table alone. I am coming to receive you with the good wishes and the goodwill of all my brothers and sisters. So we will understand our Lord's injunction in Matthew 5 verses 23-24. Therefore, if you are offering your gift at the altar and there remember that your brother has something against you, leave your gift there in front of the altar. First go be reconciled to your brother, then come and offer your gift. How different our lives, our masses, our community celebrations would be if we took this verse seriously. Last time in the season of Lent, when I came here and I gave you a testimony of a lady who has given me permission to give this testimony everywhere, I told you how she was healed from cancer, stomach cancer, by merely acting on this word immediately, leaving the church after the gospel and acting on this word. I'm going to give you another testimony for my life that happened a long time ago, but nevertheless it's as fresh in my mind as if it happened yesterday. This lady was the mother of one of the prayer group members, and she had lung cancer, and she was vomiting bowls full of blood. And the doctor, Ezekiel D'Souza, had given her only 2 weeks to live. And this prayer group member called us to her house to pray with her. And I took a group of people and we went to pray with her. And after praying with her, in front of our eyes, the bleeding stopped. And we, 3 people of the group, had 3 messages. 2 of them felt that she was healed. And I had a message from the Lord, a word of scripture. If you say to this mountain, be moved and cast into the sea, and do not doubt in your heart that it has happened, it has happened. So I told her, don't worry, the cancer is gone. That same week, we were supposed to meet with this lady, with the daughter, at one communion party or something, and she was not there. And I asked everybody why she did not come. And they told me that she's taken her mother to Shanti Avedna. You know where Shanti Avedna is? It's at Bangalore. It is for terminally ill patients. So I was very, very disturbed. And I didn't understand. And I don't know how I ate, what I ate at that party. But I came home and I told the Lord, I'm not going to sleep. I'm going to sit on this bed and I'm going to wait on you. Can you give me some answer? Because I am going to uphold your word. And if I'm not convinced about the validity of your word, I can't tell anybody else. So you give me some answer. The husband went to sleep, I sat on the bed, and I didn't sleep. And he had those dogs sitting down there, and I didn't lie down. And the whole night there was no answer from the Lord, while I kept waiting on him. At 5 o'clock in the morning, the husband got up for prayer. He went to the bathroom, came back, and he said, why are you torturing yourself? You think you understand the mind of God? Please go to sleep. Now, I knew that, but I didn't want that. And then he sat started to pray. He sat down on his bed and he started his prayer. I suppose he must have told the Lord, this is not, you please explain something to her. Because within half an hour, by 5:30, I sensed the hammering at my mind, Mark 11:22. And I didn't know what Mark 11:22 was at that time. So I put the light on, took the Bible, opened to Mark 11:22. And there it was. If you say to this mountain, be moved and cast into the sea, and you do not doubt in your heart, it has happened. It has happened. And he said, yes, Lord, this is the verse you gave me, and this is the verse I told him. And then the Lord said to me, read further. And as I read, it was, and if you stand to pray, that's Mark 11:23. When you stand to pray, forgive anyone who has anything against you, so that your Heavenly Father may forgive you. And I said, what are you saying to me, Lord? And I sensed him saying, I have forgiven, but my I have healed, but my healing cannot reach her. Because she has built a wall of unforgiveness around her. I got my answer, closed the book, put out the light and went to sleep. From 5:30 to about 7 o'clock, 1.5 hours sleep, got up as if I slept the whole night, fresh as ever. Decent enough time to bring up somebody and I'm not to say. And I said, why have you taken your mother to Shanti Avedna? Has she started vomiting blood again? She says, no, she's fine. But there is this Durga Puja going on just outside her house and there are loud speakers and she can't get sleep. So I've taken advantage of Dr. Zito's letter which says only 2 weeks to live and I have got her a nice bed and she's sleeping soundly. I said, Lord, you are so faithful. But here was I torturing myself for nothing. But then I told her, I said, the Lord did not allow me to spend a sleepless night for nothing. Is there somebody that your mother is not talking to? And she says, my brother, her own son, I don't know, who was taking whom to court for some property matter, I don't know. But I told her this verse. And I told her, now you tell your mother to decide, does she want the cancer? Or does she want to act on the word of God? Is she standing on ceremony and saying, my son should come to me first? You tell her to decide, I will pray for her. And that's what we did. That evening she said, I'm going to the hospital to work it out. And we sat here and we prayed. The Lord put it in the heart of the son to come and visit his mother. There was a beautiful reconciliation while we were praying. And this lady never died of cancer. She died of plain and simple old age. A whole 20 years later than Dr. Rizito's tools. So brothers and sisters, 1 John 4:20 says, if anyone says I love God yet hates his brother, he is a liar. For anyone who does not love his brother whom he has seen cannot love God whom he has not seen. And yet so many of us brothers and sisters, even in the renewal, are harboring hatred and resentment against people in our own homes. Tonight I'm pleading of you, do not take Matthew 5:23-24 lightly, the injunction of the Lord. It's not an ordinary piece of bread that we are consuming. It's the very heart of our God, our Creator, our Judge, one day that we are partaking of. His bloodstream is going to mingle with ours and flow in our veins. He's coming in all his divinity to anoint us with his life-giving spirit. And we receive him with anger and hatred in our hearts against our brothers and sisters, which is his mystical body. This is not the only body of Christ. This is also the body of Christ. In John 13:27, we are told that as soon as Judas took the bread, Satan entered into him. Why? Because his heart was not clean, not a fitting sanctuary for the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords. In John 13:30, we are told, as soon as Judas had taken the bread, he went out and it was night. There was darkness outside and darkness inside his soul. Brothers and sisters, if that darkness slips into our souls, it will be the beginning of a depression that is endless and interminable. Not all the doctors and medicines in the world will be able to heal us. because it is the sickness from the very pit of hell. Now, did you ever notice that in the words I, me, my do not occur even once in the Lord's Prayer? Yet while saying the Our Father, it is very easy to mean my Father with our lips. We say Our Father with our lips, but meaning my Father. It's very easy to utter, give us today our daily bread, and still think in terms of my daily bread. St. Paul tells us in this beautiful Philippians 4 that we need to be considerate about others and at peace with one another. But that's not the attitude of a lot of people today. Almost everybody is convinced that if you do not argue and complain and fight for everything you want in life, you'll never get it. So we hear them saying things that me first, everybody else last. It's my way or no way. In the body of Christ, brothers and sisters, it's supposed to be different. After all, we are all Christians saved by the grace of God. And all of us are wanting to serve the Lord, but because we are people of such diverse personalities and temperaments and ways of thinking, there will always be times when we will disagree with one another. Only last Sunday we had a priest in our parish saying Mass. He was a priest from outside because most of the priests in our parish are away at the moment on holiday. So he was telling us how in our particular parish, the original cross above the altar needed to be replaced because it was worn out. And in the parish there were two groups of people. One said that the new cross should be exactly like the old cross, if only the crucified water. The second group felt that it would be more meaningful if there was the image of the resurrected Lord on the cross. And finally, after consultation with a team of priests and the members of the parish council, one particular option was selected. And the members of the other group whose option was discarded even stopped talking to the members of this group because their suggestion was taken up. What is the Lord saying in all this? What is He telling you? What about this great commandment of love? Where are our priorities, brothers and sisters? In the United States some years ago, there was a rapidly growing congregation and they set out a questionnaire and asked the members to fill it out and send it back because they were trying to find out what the people said about certain things. And more than 200 members of that congregation filled the form and so the results were compiled. And the one thing that the survey showed so dramatically was that this was a very diverse congregation. For example, some thought that they ought to go to the bank and borrow all the money they could borrow and build all the buildings they could build immediately. Others felt they shouldn't borrow at all. Instead, they ought to wait and not build anything until they could pay cash for it. Some felt they were giving too much to the missions. Others felt who felt they were giving too much to the missions wanted to keep the money for themselves and help pay for their new buildings. Others felt they were not giving enough to the missions. They needed to give more. And so you see such a diversity of opinions. And we shouldn't be surprised by that because almost everybody has an opinion about everything, even in the church. The question is, what do we do with the diversity? Do we allow it to cripple us? Do we say we are so diverse we never agree, so we won't do anything? Or do we move forward prayerfully, realizing that some will disagree with whatever course we take? Now the word of God, brothers and sisters, this is such a marvelous passage the Lord led me to that I must share it with you. Are you there with me? Hello? Yes? Okay. The word of God gives us some guidance on this. It teaches us that the way for the church to solve the problem of various opinions is to select elders who are in tune with God and also in tune with the needs of the church or the congregation. And as we seek God's guidance in the decisions that have to be made, we need to pray for them, get behind them and support them. And where do I get all this? St. Paul says again that same beautiful chapter, Philippians 4, verses 2 and 3. I appeal to you, Euodia. Euodia, some say Euodia. And I appeal to you, Syntyche, to come to agreement with each other in the Lord. And I ask you, Cyzicus, to be truly a companion and to help them in this. These women were a help to me when I was fighting to defend the good news. And also, at the same time, were Clement and the others who worked with me. Their names are written in the book of life. And as I read this passage, I sense what the Lord was saying. Your two women, really committed Christians, who have worked side by side with the Apostle Paul, who have had a disagreement. And we have no idea what they have disagreed about. That is not true. And this is a letter to the church at Philippi. And in it, Paul has dealt with some very important matters. So why on earth, in the midst of such an important letter, does Paul stick in something so personal about two ladies in the congregation? Shouldn't he have tried to solve this problem much more discreetly and privately? Why so publicly write about it in a letter that millions have to read now for more than 2,000 years and will read till the end of time? Because, brothers and sisters, it is so important that the church communicate to the world that we don't handle disagreements the same way as the world handles them. That we are able to find common ground and agree to work in harmony with one another. Notice what Paul does and what he doesn't do. First, he doesn't take sides. He doesn't say, Syntyche is right, Euodia is wrong. So you get out of your Euodia. He doesn't do that. Secondly, he doesn't boast about his position. He doesn't say, I'm the apostle here. And therefore I say to you, if you two don't agree, you go get out of here. Instead, he encourages them to find common ground where they can agree. He says, I plead with you to agree with each other in the Lord. In Romans 12, 18, he said, if it is possible, as far as it depends on you, live at peace with everyone. There is something else that Paul does. He appoints a third party to intervene. In verse 3, he calls on Cyzicus to be truly a companion to them. And some translations refer to him as loyal yoke fellow. Yoke fellow. We don't know who he was. But whoever he was a peacemaker. And Jesus said, blessed are the peacemakers, for they will be called sons of God. Now there is nothing that Satan would rather do than divide the church. Because if he can do that, it won't be effective in giving out the good news about Jesus. So it's important, brothers and sisters, that we pledge to one another and to God that we will not allow ourselves to be used as pawns in the hands of Satan to divide his church. As we serve God together, we will be at peace with one another. In this context, let me tell you that there are two types of false peace. Listen to this. A lady once came to me for counseling. And she said to me, my husband and I hardly talk to each other. We don't speak more than what is necessary. He goes his way, I go mine. Peace is better. And I told her, that is not the peace of Jesus. That is graveyard peace. Hello, are you there? Okay. That is the peace of the graveyard that nobody speaks to anyone there. Nobody wants to get up and contradict the other. Jesus wants to give us his true peace with an intense, alive, vibrant relationship such as exists with the Trinity. Different individuals, different mentalities, yet one in heart and love, bound by the Spirit. The second type of false peace is the peace of exhausted hatred. Two people who have fought with each other have nothing more to say to each other because they have run out of words. Hello, are you there? So they decide to leave each other alone. This is not peace. Inside, they are both boiling. There is simmering hatred on both sides. I think you all know. An India-Pakistan match will draw more crowds than any IPL match. Right or not? Yes, okay. So, as we see the word Father, we get a glimpse of the nature and character of God, His forgiveness, His unconditional love. It comes from a heart that does not demand anything for itself, that is completely empty of self-seeking. He's challenging you and me, brothers and sisters, challenging us to step over all our arguments that say, how many times must I forgive? Our arguments that say, forgiveness is unwise, unhealthy, impractical. How can we forgive, forget what has been done? He's challenging me to step over all our needs for gratitude and compliments. He's asking me to step over that wounded part of my heart that feels hurt and wronged, that wants to stay in control and put conditions on the one who has hurt me. And really, this stepping over is not easy. Often I have to climb over arguments and angry feelings that I have elected between myself and all those whom I love, but who so often do not return that love. It's the wall of fear that I have sometimes of being used or hurt again. It is a wall of pride and the desire to stay in control. But I know in my heart that every time I take a step over or climb over that wall, I enter to the house where my Father lives. And there I touch my neighbor with His genuine, compassionate love. And so this, brothers and sisters, is Ephesians 4:3. Paul keeps on making appeals, make every effort to keep the unity of the Spirit through the bond of peace. Now I come to the second part, peace within us. If I were to give a subtitle to this fruit of the Spirit, I would call it the Spirit's security. The fruit that makes the Holy Spirit put His security in us, because we have in us His unshakable peace. The whole world is looking for peace in all the wrong places. But everything in this world is so deceptive and so short-lived that only God can give us His peace. Before He went to His death, Jesus said, "Peace I give to you. My peace I give to you, not as the world gives, do I give." John 14:27. His first words after His resurrection were, "Peace be with you," followed by, "Receive the Holy Spirit." As if to say, there, I'm giving you the secret of peace, the source of true peace, my Holy Spirit. Two painters painted a picture to show their idea of peace. The first one painted a solitary, still lake in the far off mountains. The second one threw on his canvas a thundering waterfall and a very fragile birch tree bending over the foam. And almost at the fork there of that branch, wet with the spray, sat a robin in its nest. And the critics were asked to comment on the two paintings. And one of them said, "The first picture, solitary one lake, gives the idea of stagnation. The second one, the robin in the middle of the waterfall, is rest, peace." So brothers and sisters, Christ's life outwardly was very busy. All the bloodthirsty people chasing Him, close on His heels. But in His heart, there was always a deep peace. You could come to Him at any time and find peace. So He could confidently say, "Come all of you who are overburdened, I will give you rest." So while we see what destroys our peace, at the same time, let us see the type of peace that Jesus offers us. In John 14:27, he says, "My peace I leave with you." And in the same breath he said, "Let not your hearts be troubled." Probably today's reading. So when our hearts are troubled, our peace is destroyed. As we look closely at Jesus' words, we ask, does Jesus mean that we should have no troubles? No, not at all. Jesus is not a daydreamer to think that we shall have no troubles in life. He knows that trouble is our companion, inseparable on earth. So what does he mean? What he means is that troubles should not overcome us, rather we should overcome them. Everything that is good in life, brothers and sisters, is a result of a struggle that is acquired through struggle. Whatever we have not worked for is not worth having. So peace does not exist apart from trouble. Trouble is the raw material for peace. Jesus doesn't want us to run after trouble. He doesn't want us to court it. And he definitely doesn't want us to create it. But when it comes, he wants us to accept it and with his strength move to that deep inner calm and self-composure that comes from Jesus and his presence. He wants us to find peace in the middle of trouble, like that robin in the heart of the thundering waterfall. So why do we lose our peace? Because we have our own fixed ideas of happiness. We may be wanting someone to change, and all the time God is saying, you change, and the change in you will change. Or maybe we want a particular type of career, or we are pursuing a particular type of dream. Like I always wanted a two-bedroom flat. I drove my poor husband nuts, argued enough with the Lord about it, giving him a million reasons why I thought I deserved it. And the Lord healed me of that desire completely. One day I was reading scripture, this line from Matthew's Gospel, Matthew 6:8, "For your Father knows what you need." That word "needs" seems to be jumping out of the pages of the book. And that moment I sense the Lord telling me, you don't need a two-bedroom flat, you need a roof over your head to have. You want a two-bedroom flat. My Father may not always give you what you want, but he will never deprive you of your needs. And at that moment I prayed a prayer of surrender, and the Lord heard my prayer. He healed me permanently of the desire of a new and bigger house. And he has filled our home so much with his presence that I wouldn't exchange my own to this mansion in the world. Are we hankering after the things of this world, running here and there in pursuit of our own ideas of happiness, forcing the Lord to go ahead of us and close the door firmly? And then we come to the point of surrender, of anger and resentment in our hearts, saying, what to do? Nothing is working out. God's will be done. What can't be cured must be endured. But that is not the type of peace and surrender that the Lord wants. He's aching to take us in his arm and whisper in our ears, "My peace I give to you, not as the world gives. You don't know what you are running after. I know your character. I know your temperament. I know your future. You are not asking for bread. You are asking for stone. I can't give you a snake instead of fish. I love you. Here I am, Lord, I come to do your will." These are the shortest sentences in the Bible, yet the most pleasing to the ear of the Lord. They run like a common thread from Genesis to Revelation. Abraham said them. Moses said them. Elijah said them. Isaiah said them. All the prophets said them. Mary said them. Jesus said them. It's as if there is a roll call is being taken. Everyone is answering, present, 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 present. There is only one present that is missing. Adam, where are you? No, here I am, Lord. I'm hiding because I'm naked. Who told you you are naked? And we know the rest of it. Perhaps if Adam had come forward and said, Here I am, Lord. I am sorry I disobeyed you. The whole course of history would have changed. Who knows? I don't know. Peace, brothers and sisters, comes from joyfully accepting God's will for us in the here and now. Being content with what He has blessed us with, not hankering after the things of this world. Another reason why we lose our peace is because of worry and anxiety. Again, Philippians 4:6-7, St. Paul tells us, that is the other half of this sentence, there is no need to worry, but if there is anything you need, pray for it, asking for it with prayer and thanksgiving. And then the second part, that peace of God which is so much greater than we can understand will guard your hearts and your thoughts in Christ Jesus. Jesus, in that famous passage in Matthew 6:25-34, in which He speaks about the birds of the air being fed, the lilies of the field being clothed by the Heavenly Father, tells us at least four times in those few verses not to worry. He points out to us the uselessness of worrying. St. Peter in his letter, 1 Peter 5:7, asks us to cast all our cares on Him, for He cares for you. And yet, all of us can say to all these sentences, that is easier said than done. A man had a wife who was a chronic worrier, and she worried about anything and everything. She worried that the children were not being educated in the best college in town, that she had only two new dresses, that the roof was leaking, that the dog was sick, etc., etc. One day at work, her husband received a letter in his name from the lawyer of his aunt Emily, who had died. And the lawyer told him that his aunt had left him $500,000. He so excitedly phones his wife and gives her the good news. She too was overjoyed. Yet when he returned home that evening, he found her sitting morose in the kitchen. And he asked her, now what is it? Aunt Emily's money will pay for everything. She said, I know. Well then, what are you worrying about? And she said,